This is the third lecture for the subject Marketing Management for BM 370. And in today's lecture, we are going to discuss two very important topics of the syllabus related to consumer behavior and market segmentation. The entire syllabus PPT presentation has been divided into two broad categories. In the first one, we are going to speak about basis of consumer behavior, followed by segmentation. In the last units, we've been talking much about what consumer behavior is, how consumer behavior is important to all the marketing activities. Typically, for the first time, we are going to understand what are the various dynamics related to consumers' behavior, why at all a study of consumer behavior is of significance to the marketing department as such. The simplest definition to understand what is consumer behavior states that all the activities that people undertake when they are obtaining, consuming and disposing products and services is related to the study of consumer behavior. While obtaining, while consuming and while disposing, the behaviors that they display is of paramount importance to the marketer. This figure helps us understand that there are three broad activities that they undertake, obtain, consume and dispose. And while they are doing it, every consumer is affected by various forces which are operating in the nature. That can be divided into two broad categories. The one is consumer's individual influences and the other one is the organization influences. If we try to see who a personal consumer is, then one needs to understand that there is a basic difference in the two words, consumer and customers. Consumer is anybody who consumes or who is the final user of the product in question, whereas customer is anybody who has the money to buy it and who goes into the market to obtain it from the market. Why the study of consumer behavior is important? That's because it forms the basis for all marketing applications in the form of developing proper market segmentation, selection of the target market, positioning your product into the market, or whether it is about the four P's of marketing mix, developing product decisions, pricing decisions, distribution decisions and promotion decisions. Finally, we can say that in order to develop a better understanding of the consumption behavior of consumers so that a company can appropriately develop marketing strategies and action plans, the study of consumer behavior becomes significant. This is a simplified model of consumer behavior which helps us understand that a consumer undergoes through a five-stage decision-making process. The steps being clear here. The first step is problem recognition. The second is pre-purchase search. The third is alternative evaluation. The fourth is purchase. And the fifth one is post-purchase behavior. Why he is doing all that? He is affected by a number of factors which are either existing within the human being or they are being exerted from the point of view of the company. If you see that the first section is here, these are the firm's marketing efforts, the influential factors in the form of the four P's: product, price, place and promotion. And if we see here, we see there are certain, you know, every consumer has a certain social cultural background. These are what is stated here in the form of culture, subculture, social group, references and family. Whereas these are the internal or the psychological factor that every consumer has which makes him distinct from the other one in the form of motivation, perception, learning, personality and aptitude. If you try to look at a more focused look at what the consumer behavior process is all about, we see that the first three processes gets affected by almost all the three type of factor, whereas the last two processes in turn have an effect on the other factors which gets settled into the minds of the consumer on the basis of his experiences or observations or learning. In the second part, we see that we are going to touch upon four more important aspects of consumer behavior in the forms of what are the factors which influence this behavior. We are going to see something which is known as the stimulus response model or the black box model. We are going to see in detail the stages of the buying decision making process and finally what are the different types of buyer behavior. Let's start with the simplest of them all, which is known as the stimulus response model. It looks something like this. A simple response model, or known as the black box model. Any initiation or any spark from the side of the company when affects the organism is expected to generate certain response or reaction from him. So if a company wants to generate a consumer to undertake an action in the form of a purchase, all those efforts that the company will generate from their end will come into the stimulus. A detailed view of this diagram looks something like this. The stimuluses can be broadly divided into two categories, the marketing stimuli as well as the other stimuli. The marketing stimuli are typically the four P's, whereas the other stimuli are typically the external environmental factors that we have studied in the last lecture, which is known as the PEST analysis: political, economical, social and technological. Now, when these stimuli act upon the organism, there are certain responses which are expected from them in the form of the choice of product that you will exercise, the brand you choose, the dealer you choose, the purchasing time, amount of frequency that you would like. In addition to that, why is that every consumer generates a different response typically depends on this center black box, and that is why this model is also known as the black box model. It is here where every consumer is assessed on the basis of two important things. One is his characteristics in the form of his background, his personality, his thinking and his orientation. And the second is the way he undertakes a decision making process. That is, whether he is a quick decision taker or whether he takes his own sweet time in going through each stage. A detailed view of this figure looks something like this. If we talk about some of the most important characteristics of buyer, we will see that it is his attitude, motivation, perception, personality, lifestyle and knowledge. On the other hand, this section helps us understand the typical 5-stage decision making process, which begins from need identification, information search, evaluation of alternatives, purchase decision and post-purchase behavior. This is a cross-detailed analysis of what are the different factors which influence a buyer's behavior. Or you can say that these are the various bases on which consumers may differ in the choices that they make out of all the available alternatives into the market. The most broad category is that of the culture. The second is the social classification. The third is the personal classification. And the fourth one is the psychological classification. Let us discuss the first one. The cultural factors. Every consumer has got a certain culture. This is decided by the nationality or the region a person stays in. Every culture has got certain subcultures which are more closely defined by the group of people you are associated with. And the third is the social class, which is depicted by the locality you stay in. So, we can say that there are various cultures like American, or we say the Western culture, or European culture, or Australian culture, Chinese culture. Within the Indian culture, we have got various subcultures like we have got Hinduism, Jainism, Sikhism, Muslims, and they have got different, you know, gods to pray, different languages to speak, different clothes that they, you know, consider auspicious, different festivals that they celebrate. And finally, we have got a social class, which is the typical distribution of audiences or consumers into different social stratas on the basis of their economic standards. So we have got the middle class, lower class and the upper class. The second important understanding from here is that social classes are relatively homogeneous and important divisions in a society which are hierarchically ordered and whose members share similar values, interests and behavior. What is interesting to note is that a social class gives people a hierarchy of placement. The people who are at a lower level are considered to be slightly lower in terms of their interests, opinions or the products that they would reach out in order to satisfy the needs, whereas the people at the top class are considered to be the affluent ones who are going to reach out for the most expensive or luxurious brand available to reach out. And therefore, this distribution of customers into social classes becomes of relevant importance. The second factor is the social factors. The three important categories here in our reference group: family and roles and statuses. A closer look helps us understand that reference group consists of all the group that have a direct or indirect influence on the person's attitude or behavior. Groups having a direct influence on a person are called membership group or the direct group, and indirect reference groups are the ones where a person does not relatively meet a person on a face-to-face basis, but it still has the person has the ability to influence the consumer's behavior. Some of the most popular reference groups can be divided into two categories: the aspirational group and the dissociative group. Aspirational group are those groups which a person wishes to join and hopes to join. The dissociative group are those where a person is not interested in being a part of the group, and rather he more so rejects the idea of that particular group. Here, somebody like an opinion leader is of very great significance. This opinion leader is a person who is considered to be a person of integrity. He is considered to be a person of expert knowledge. He is considered to be a specialist person, and therefore the chances that he may influence the decision of the consumers are very high. Companies constantly look out for these opinion leaders who have the power to direct or steer the consumers in a particular direction. The second important factor under the social category is the family. Family is considered to be the first school where a child learns almost all the things. What we consume, what we like, what we dislike is most of the time driven by the way our families have taught us. A person becomes a vegetarian, a person chooses to be a non-vegetarian because the family teaches, the gods that we worship, the books that we read, the type of orientations we have regarding to moving to places or watching movies is all governed by our family. Two types of important families are there. We have got a family of procreation, which is consisting of one's spouse and children, and we have got a family of orientation, which is consisting of one's parent along with the siblings. Typically in India, we have got two types of family. Just see, we have got a nuclear versus joint family. So most of the time, a company is interested in knowing whether families are the small families consisting of only the spouse and the children, or whether the companies are joint families consisting of large number of family members. This will help the company to decide the packaging of the products that they are bringing out into the market. Larger the families, they are more interested in buying bulk in one time or more quantity in one time, so that they do not have to indulge into repeat purchase again and again. The roles and statuses are every person who is a power of the society has got a certain role to perform and therefore has got a certain status, or vice versa. They have got a certain status in the society and therefore they have to perform the role appropriately. So a person who is working in the organization as a CEO has a different status and therefore has to have different types of clothes, has a different car to drive, or say a different mobile to use. On the other hand, a person who is working at a shop floor or as a supervisor within the organization has an altogether different status and therefore has to use different things in terms of the brands which are available to the market. It says that a person participates in many groups, family, club, organization. This is also one interesting way of looking at it. So when a person is going out for a business meeting, his type of clothing will be different. But when a person is going out with a friends to enjoy or having a day out, his choice of clothing will be different, which makes it easier for the company to reach out to the consumers according to the occasion for the clothes that they are selling. The third category is the personal influences. The simple demography of a consumer in terms of his age, his family life cycle, his income, occupation, or his lifestyle, they are all covered herein. The simple classification of products based on the gender, razors and shaving creams, on the other hand, lipsticks and nail paints, they make it clear that they are gender specific. But then there are certain unisexual products also, for example, toothpaste, so toothbrushes. Of course, a company can classify toothbrushes also on the basis of gender by providing darker shades for the males and the lighter shades for the female. However, there is no concrete background towards it. But then still, one of the most applicable methods of distributing consumers can be on the basis of their gender or their age. The lifestyle of a person is the pattern of living in the world, as expressed in terms of the activities that he undertakes, the interests that he has, and the opinion that he has towards it. The lifestyle portrays the whole person interacting with his or her environment. As in, a personality of the person is the sum total of the ways in which he acts and reacts with all that which is happening around. So you may have people who may be outgoing, you may have people who may be introverts, you may have people who may be shy, you may have people who are temperamental, so who are adventurous. So companies have to accordingly target their audiences, and this AIO study makes it easier for the company to distribute their customers on the basis of their personality traits. Next important factor which determines a consumer's behavior is his self-concept. If by personality we mean distinguishing the psychological characteristics that lead to relatively environmental, consistent and enduring responses, by self-concept we mean how a person looks at oneself and how does he want others to see him. And therefore, if a person by nature is shy but then wants people to see him as an adventurous or a happy-go-lucky type, he is more likely to reach out to a product which portrays that self. And therefore, companies try to show goody-goody picture of almost all the products which are available into the market and try to reduce the ignore the negative aspects of a person's lifestyle. The most important factors which determine the way a person consumes certain things can be on the basis of the psychological factors. Four important psychological factors are discussed herein. We'll be talking about motivation, perception, learning and builds an attitude. Talking about the first one, motivation. It typically looks like this. Every consumer has got certain needs. This is Abraham Maslow's need hierarchy theory, in which all of his needs have been classified into broad five heads, and they are presented here in the ladder format. The basic or the need, which is at the lowest, is the physiological need, rising up in safety needs, social needs, esteem needs, and the self-actualization need. People who are there in the market to buy the basic products are there to satisfy their biogenic needs, and therefore would fall at the lowest level. At the above level, once a person is content in the form of the food, clothing and shelter that he or she seeks, they look out for safety or security needs of protection. Once that need is satisfied, they look out for sense of belongingness, affection and love. Once that is done, they look out for the fourth set of need, which is the need for self-esteem and recognition into the market. And the last one is self-actualization. Every product that you see into the market is there to provide these one or the other sort of needs. So, you know, there would be a person who would buy a car from the market simply to, you know, satisfy a basic need of having a car. There would be a person who would buy a car, one which has got a sturdy body, one which has got a good ground clearance, so that a car would give, you know, a steady and safe drive. There would be somebody who would just buy a car, just in order to make people see that he has bought a car which is most popular amongst all the others. So a car which says that, driving this car will make your family happy. A person who is looking out surely for social needs, need of love. And then there are big cars. The cars, you know, owning one gives you a sense of pride, gives you a sense of accomplishment. Then comes in the self-esteem need. So a car like an Esteem or a Verona, or say a Volkswagen Vento or Jetta would perhaps fall in there. And then comes self-actualization. Perhaps, having one car which makes you distinct from all the others would be categorized in there. So if anybody who has a Rolls Royce Phantom, or say if anybody has got a superior class Mercedes, would surely fall in there in the self-actualization categories. The second set of psychological factor is perception. Perception is one's way of looking at things. There are certain consumers who consider imported products to be of more quality, and the nationally made products to be of inferior quality. A company has to change its perception, and therefore if it is about making a comparison between a chocolate like Cadbury and an Indian made chocolate, naturally a consumer will find Cadbury more qualitative, more better. Learning is a resultant of a change in behavior. If you are a constant collector of information, if you are a constant lookout to gain more and more information from where you can, it's surely going to add to your knowledge base and enhance your learning. Learning will in time have a change in your perception and is more likely to generate positive attitudes from you, which lies at the center of all the decision making, the beliefs and attitude. Attitudes are a person's favorable or unfavorable enduring feelings towards a particular situation, a product or a person associated with a product. And therefore, companies are constantly looking out for consumers on the basis of those who have got favorable attitude and those who have got unfavorable attitude. Thus, it becomes easier for them to charge those people who are having a favorable attitude to help company to convert the people with non-favorable attitude. If we talk in terms of the decision-making process, before going into it, it's important to learn that there are different types of bias behavior. As the situations differ, so is going to be the involvement level. Naturally, a product which is more pricey has got more risk involved, and therefore a consumer will be more involved in the purchase process. On the other hand, a regularly purchased product which has got less price and which involves less risk is sure to have less involvement from the consumer. On that basis, we have divided, we have developed this four sector quadrant, where we see that there are brands into the market which have got significant differences amongst them. There are brands into the market which are more likely similar to each other. We see that consumers are likely to depict a high involvement, and sometimes they depict a low involvement. On that basis, we have got four buying behavior. The first one is here, the complex buying behavior. It happens when the brand amount of involvement that a consumer indulges in is very, very high, and naturally, which means that the product is pricey and the risk involved is also considered to be high. And therefore, the products which are available into the market are significantly different. So if you are going into the market to buy a car, a Maruti is much different from a BMW. And therefore, as the price increases, so is your involvement. Such buying behavior is termed as the complex buying behavior. On the other hand, although the brands in the market are more or less similar, still if a person indulges into a high involvement, the type of buying behavior is known as dishonest inducing buying behavior. Say for example, you are there to buy gold from the unorganized market, or if you are there to buy petrol from any petrol pump, you know, they more or less look the same. But then still, a consumer exhibits something which is known as dishonest inducing buying behavior. It typically means any buying behavior that a consumer displays in order to reduce the dissatisfaction of the last time, that is known as dishonest reducing buying behavior. The third one is when the consumer involves is indulging into a low involvement, which means that the product may not be that pricey, is known as habitual buying behavior. It happens when there are few differences between the brands. So if you are talking about a brand of salt, or if you are talking about a brand of sugar salting market, a consumer will display a habitual buying behavior. And the last one is known as variety seeking buying behavior. This happens when the consumer displays a low involvement, even though the brands existing in the market are highly different. For example, you are talking about a brand of biscuit, or if you are talking about, say, a brand of chocolate from the market, because you know, a Cadbury is definitely different from any other Nestle or Amul brand, but still a consumer may indulge into low involvement. It is interesting to know that out of habit, a person will go into the market and keep on buying the same product over and over again. Whereas out of variety seeking buying behavior, the next time a person goes into the market, there are chances that he may end up buying a typically new product. But the funny part is, a habitual buying behavior does not in any way communicate that a person has high level of satisfaction with his past purchase. It is just out of his habit that he doesn't want to shift from his status quo, that he ends up buying the same product over and over again. On the other hand, here, it is a person's typical nature to try a different brand of ice cream every time, or he wants to buy a different brand of biscuit every time, and therefore he ends up into buying a variety, displaying a variety seeking buying behavior. And thus, a variety seeking buying behavior does not communicate a high level of dissatisfaction from the last brand that you have purchased. If we discuss the stages of the consumer buying behavior, as I've just told you that there are five stages, beginning from problem recognition. This is the stage where the consumer identifies that there is some need which is unfulfilled in his life and he needs something out there to reduce this state of tension. In that search, he goes into the market to collect information. The source of information can be anybody, your friends, your relatives, internet, commercial sources, magazines, anybody or anywhere from where you can get information in order to satisfy your need can be a source of potential source of information. Once enough need is collected, we enter into the third stage, which is evaluation of alternatives. This is where a consumer, on the basis of the time that he has, on the basis of the budget that he has, and on the basis of the propensity of need that he has, he actually decides which brand he has to pick up and which brand he cannot afford. The fourth stage is the purchase decision, where he makes a choice out of all the brands which are available, and in the last one he provides a feedback in the form of post-purchase behavior. What typically happens is this: while a person is making a decision, he passes on through several phases. The first one is, say for example, a person is looking out for a brand of laptop in the market. The total number of brands which are available will form the first set, which is known as the total set. Out of this, only a few brands will shift into the next category, which is known as the awareness set. Through information search, these are the brands about which he's been told either by his friends or by his work colleagues or by his family members, or say certain information commercial sources. So these will constitute the awareness set. Out of these, only 2 or 3 or 4 will pass to the next category, which is known as the consideration set. Based on the budget that you have, based on the amount of time that the product will take to reach you, you will select a few. Out of these, you know, just a 2 or 3 will pass on to your choice set. These are the ones amongst from which you are going to make your final selection, and the one that you select will form the final set, which is known as the decision set. However, you know, this decision does not mean that the purchase has taken place. It typically means that the person has got an intention to buy. And so, you know, there have been several instances. There are certain happenings in life which may not let you convert your intention to buy into a purchase act. So what actually happens is, once you evaluate the alternatives, you develop something which is known as the purchase intention. But then your purchase intention may not get converted into the purchase act because of two things. The one is attitude of others, which is typically known as the word of mouth, the last minute discussion with any of your reference group members or any of your friends who tell you something negative about a product, and know, suddenly somebody in the house falls ill, and because of which you cannot you postpone your purchase act, or you are not no longer interested in doing so, will not let you take a purchase decision. And therefore, companies have to make sure that as soon as a person is interested in buying, they should not leave the person free. You know, and that is why the home delivery things or the cash on delivery things, as far as the online purchase is concerned, are now converting this purchase intention into purchase very, very quickly. These are some of the roles that people perform in a buying process. Some of the most important roles that they perform are initiator, influencer, decider, purchaser, and user. If we, you know, try to understand them, say for example, a child at home needs a new dress, okay, and has to go into a party, and therefore the child goes up to the mother and says that he needs a new dress. The influencer in this case will be the elder brother or sister, or say a grandparent at home, who will help, you know, the mother realize that yes, the child needs a dress now. The decider would be the mother and the father together. When the, you know, father comes in the evening from office, and once they have a discussion about this, they can be the decider. The purchaser can be anybody who pays the money. It can be the grandparent, or it can be the parents who actually pay for the dress. And the user, but for in the end, is going to be the child. But let's take a look at a different example. Tea, you know, a tea where most of the time members of the family are not at all interested in which brand the mother, the lady of the house, brings. So the mother in herself is an initiator. She gets influenced by her neighbors or by her friends or by her relatives. She ends up deciding for herself which she is going to buy. She goes into the market and buys the same brand. And when she comes back, the entire family and the family members are using it. Two more additional roles are written here. We have got a gatekeeper and we have got an approver. Both of them are opposite to each other. Whereas an approver is that one person who may or may not be the money payer, who may or may not be an actual user of the product, but still has the authority to approve the final purchase. So if in case a child is making a decision of taking admission into a school or into a college, a parent will act as an approver. They have to give the final sanction to the choice that the child has made. Gatekeeper is that one person who has the ability to withhold or ignore certain information, or he is the person who acts as a gatekeeper in the true sense of the word and doesn't let certain information pass from here to here. So say for example, a child in the family is in the need of a new bike, and if the child wants this information to be communicated to the parent, and the elder sibling is here, the elder sibling is typically acting as the gatekeeper and doesn't let the information float through. These are some of the important roles. So if we just understand, we have had a glimpse of what are the various types of buying behavior, what is the buying decision process like, what are the roles a person performs, and what are the various factors that influences a consumer's buying behavior. This section concludes our consumer buying behavior. And let's enter into the next segment of this slideshow, where we will speak about segmentation. Naturally, it is not possible for a company to make a product which will be equally acceptable by all the consumers into the market. And therefore, it is not even possible for the companies to make different types of product which match the requirements of the different segments of the consumers. What is ideally required is a company should develop a study of, develop an understanding of the buying behavior of its consumers, divide them into different segments or classes, and pick up that consumer segment which they are most likely to serve in the most in the best possible manner. That is typically the aim of segmentation. The definitions say that segmentation is essentially an identification of the subsets of buyer within a market that share a similar need and demonstrate similar buying behavior. So all the people who have got similar needs should be put into one segment or one class. Segmentation is made to match different group of buyers with different sets of need and the buyer behavior. Such a group so obtained is what is known as a segment. In another word, we are saying that the world is made up of people who have got heterogeneous or different need. Our task is to collect all those people who have got homogeneous or similar requirement, and thus clubbing them together to develop a substantial number of consumers that you will be required to serve with one product. Segmentation is about pulling these similar ones into a group called segment. If we try to see how the segmentation is done, what we typically are trying to do is a customer can be classified into a market segment by the customer's individual characteristics. These characteristics can be anything. You can divide the consumers on the basis of their gender, so males together and females together, on the basis of price that they are willing to pay. So there are people who want to buy the cheap price product, or there are people who want to buy the high price product. You are looking out for people who are at a particular location, or say people who are from different religions, or say people from who are from high income segment or low income segment, or it can be done on the basis of the size of household, whether people are into a nuclear family or joint family, are they bachelors or are they married. These are some of the most popular ways on which market can be segmented. Now, what are the objectives of market segmentation? To understand the needs, wants and desires and buying habits of the customer, most important, because it is on this basis that the company will determine what they want to make. Second is to formulate a marketing program for each consumer group according to the nature. This will also help us in determining what should be the pricing approach, what should be the placement approach, what should be the promotion line. To develop new products according to the consumer's changing need. And you know, if in this segmentation we see that a particular product which was there in the past is now not like that much, the company should get an alarm that this is the time to change. Market segmentation also helps the companies to realize which are the markets which have been untapped, and therefore to increase and expand their market share. It helps the company to provide satisfaction to the consumers by serving them better, by understanding their attitudes, interests and opinion. And finally, marketing strategies and policies for consumer should be made consumer oriented, and therefore a study of market segmentation is very, very important. The three important activities of the marketing strategy. They say that the first step is segmentation S, the second one is targeting T, and the third one is positioning P. The simple STP is referred to as identifying and profiling distinct group of buyers who differ in their needs and preferences. Then selecting one or more market segments to enter, and finally establishing and placing and communicating the distinctive benefits of the market offering to the target audiences in the way of positioning. But you know, before going any further, it is important for us to understand what a market segment is. So from all that we have learned till now, we can conclude that a market segment consists of group of customers who share a similar set of needs and what. It is very important to understand that we are not talking about people who have got same needs, but we are talking about people who have got similar needs and wants. There are various levels at which segmentation can take place. Segmentation is also referred to as micro-marketing. So we have tried to explain four important levels of marketing. It looks like this. The first one is segment. So an identifiable large group of customers with similar sets of needs and wants would constitute a segment. A segment is a large collection of people who can be satisfied with one type of a product. But then there would be a few people who would not be interested in the products which will be accepted by the segment, and then they constitute somebody who is known as the niche market. This is a relatively smaller group of customers, very few customers who have got very distinctive requirements, and they know that the product which is going to satisfy their needs is not going to come cheap and easy, and therefore they are ready to pay a premium price also. The third category is that of the local areas. So there are people who are serving into specific geographical locations, into specific geographical areas, who will fall into this category. And finally, we have got individuals who, where we are typically talking about the customized services that the companies are offering. If we talk about the preference segmented, our audiences can be divided into three categories. We have got homogeneous preferences, where almost all the consumers want the similar types of things. We have got diffuse preferences, where the consumers want, but the things are very different from each other. And clustered preferences is the most acceptable or most looked out form of a preference segment, where the consumers fall into national segments, whereas each group will have got certain shared preferences. There are five criteria which should be met out in order to generate effective segmentation, which can be known as measurable, substantial, accessible, differentiable and actionable, which means that there should be a certain number in the form of finiteness of your sample. The number of samples should be enough to generate enough profit for the company. They should be actionable in the sense, accessible in the sense that a company should be able to reach out to the consumers and provide the goods to them. Differentiable, so two segments should have almost two different types of products which will satisfy their needs and wants, and thus they not only differ in the types of product they want, but they also differ in the way they react to those products. And finally, actionable, which means that the so-called segments should be serviceable. If we try to divide the consumer market, there are four broad segments, basis on which the market can be segmented. The first one is the geographical segmentation, where we are typically talking about the people who are situated in the different locations of the country, or say people who are in India and who are outside India. So if we talk about the examples of products like McDonald's, when they decided to come to India, they actually knew that the cuisines that they are serving in the other parts of the world will not be accepted in India, because people here have different taste towards non-vegetarian, and thus they had to delete beef and pork when they were coming here. And what they typically have is in the form of a macaroni tikki, which is a very low price economic version that they have nowhere to offer other than in India. The second one is the demographic segmentation, the basic personality profile of a consumer in the form of his age, gender, nationality, income status, marital status will fall in here. So if you are talking about a product like Dove, it is, you know, typically targeted for females in the form of gender. That is what we are talking about: age, life cycle, life stages, gender, income, generation and social classes. If we talk in terms of behavioral segmentation, these are some of the variables which help us understand that a consumer is bound to behave differently on the basis of these certain variables. Let's talk about the first one, occasion. So we are typically talking about consumers restricting their buying act on a few selected occasions only. For example, gold and new cars were typically bought in India a few years back only if there was a wedding to the family, or if the biggest Indian festival of Diwali was there. But today the company has increased the reasons, have increased the occasions on which a consumer can end up buying a car, not only on Diwali but on any other month of the year also. For example, we see that people end up buying cars in the month of March and April, because that is the time they are looking out for a depreciation to be entered into their ITRs, and therefore forms one very important reason. We can also discuss the example of Cadbury's. Initially, people thought that chocolates were only a child's interest, but Cadbury has virtually changed the way an audience has an understanding of the chocolate industry. Today, chocolate has been made a replacement of the sweets, which are a part and parcel of Indian families' daily life. Every month we have got certain festivals, and the chocolate is an integral part of those festivals. But then Cadbury has replaced the sweets with these chocolates. The third one is benefits. So today, consumers are not out there into the market to buy a product for just one basic reason. They are looking out for certain, cumulative reasons to buy a product. So if they are buying a toothpaste, they just do not want a dental cream which will clean their teeth, but they are looking out for something which will fight bad breath, which is going to cure the gums, which is going to heal the gums and all. And therefore, they are looking out for a germy check type of a complete formula. If somebody is there to buy a shampoo, they are not just looking out for something which is going to cleanse their hair, but they are looking for something which is going to repair their hair, which is going to nourish the scalp, and which is going to give conditioned lively hair. That's the idea. The third one is the user status. We are typically talking about consumers being divided into different categories on the basis of their regular user, one-time user, ex-user, and so on and so forth. The usage rate, we can divide the consumers on the basis of the usage rate into light users, medium users, and heavy users. So for somebody who uses a shampoo on a regular basis, would be considered to be a heavy user. For somebody who uses a shampoo, say once a week, would be considered to be a light user. And for somebody who uses a shampoo twice a week, would be considered to a medium user. The interesting ones are the last three. If we talk about the buyer readiness rate, this brand funnel illustrates the variations in the buyer readiness rate. It helps us understand that the consumers can be divided into six broad categories. There are people who are aware, there are people who have ever tried the product, there are people who have recently tried, occasional buyers are there, regular users are there, and most often used people are there. If the people fall into this category, these are the people who can be used as the brand endorsers or the testimonials for the company. If the people is here, it's important to know that if a person does not have enough information, it is the company's duty to inform the person and make him aware about the benefits, potential benefits that the product can provide. If a person has ever tried it, the company can try to get in touch with them and convert them into a regular user. A recent trial of one is more easy to convert because he has had a very recent experience and the influences are going to be strong into his mind. Occasional user is somebody who is displaying a likeness towards your product but is not using on a regular basis. A different strategy needs to be adopted for this one. The next one is the loyalty status. There are typical four layers of loyalty that you can see into the market. The first one is a switcher, a person who does not display any consistency in his buying behavior. So if you are talking about, say, a brand of chocolate, he ends up buying a different brand of chocolate every time. A shifting loyalty is a person who uses one brand, and then as soon as another brand comes into, you know, knowledge, he shifts on to the next one. And then he shifts on to the third one and the fourth one, and never returning back to the original one where he or she started. A split loyalty is the one who has his or her loyalty divided into two or three brands into the market. So he makes an initial choice of the most popular two or three brands into the market and then divides his loyalty. And therefore, if need be, he's going to buy one brand. If his preferred brand is not there, he'll end up buying the second brand. If somehow he's not willing to buy the second brand, he'll end buying the third brand. But then, in any case, he's going to split his loyalty and keep jumping amongst the three brands that he's chosen. But if a company gets to find somebody like this, who's a hardcore loyal, that's the best that can happen to a company. Somebody who's associated with the company, with, you know, mind, body and soul. Somebody who's not ready to bust from it. Somebody who's going to stay with you till eternity and who promises to give you his commitment and his patronization for that product that you are offering to him. But then it is funny that hardcore consumers are very difficult to find. The last one is attitude, where we have just now spoken about attitude to the consumer behavior part, and where I told you that it is a person's favorable and unfavorable enduring feelings towards a person, product or a service. And therefore, it is important for a company to find out the people who have got a favorable set of attitude and people who are unfavorably inclined, and thus convert the unfavorable one into the favorable one. The last task that a company does after segmenting the market is that of targeting. There are five typical targeting strategies that a company can follow. The first pattern is this one here, which is known as a single segment. Here the M's, they display the market 1, market 2 and market 3, and P displays product 1, product 2 and product 3. This strategy helps us understand that the company has selected one single segment where they are willing to target themselves. So it's just in this market they have got this product. So if you talk about a product like a Rolls Royce, so they have, you know, they are just there into the car segment, and they have the premium luxury car market that they are serving, a single segment consideration. The second one is selective specialization, where a company has got different type of product for different markets. So you know, you can have somebody who's making a car for them, who's making, say, electronics for them, and who's making something for them. So numerous examples are there where a company has got different types of products. So we can talk about Unilever, who have got a tea which they make for the premium class in the form of Taj Mahal. We have got a soap that they make for the low class people in the form of Jai, Nima or Beef. And we have them making water purifiers, again for the middle class people. So selective specialization. The third type of strategy is where a company excels in the product that they serve, and they make it for all the markets. So we have got, say, let's talk about Hyundai. So they have got a car starting from the Centro, i10, i20, and then goes on and on, and then you have got the pricey version, so they provide for everybody. There's the market specialization, where a company specializes for a product to be served to only one type of market. So let's take example of Johnson & Johnson. They have got typically all the type of products for the kids, the infants, and therefore they're just targeting the kids. Market specialization. The last strategy, of course, is the most common strategy, which is known as the full market coverage, where the company has got different types of products for the different market segment. There are various companies who are going into this segment and who intends to cover the entire market with all the different types of products that they provide. In today's lecture, we have seen two most important topics of the entire syllabus of marketing. We have covered consumer behavior and the factors associated with it, and we have also spoken about segmentation and targeting. The next lecture that we are going to take up, we are going to start with the four P's of marketing mix, and we are going to speak about product.